Okay, now we're going to discuss the physiology of the rectum and how we defecate. Okay, so the rectum and the anal sphincter have to be able to keep stool in and let stool out when necessary. And there are three muscles that contribute to that sphincter. Internal anal sphincter, the external anal sphincter, and the puborectalis muscle. Furthermore, we have a sharp angle called the anorectal angle that blocks the passage out from the colon, and also the sphincter is elevated from the pelvic floor, which also helps to block the passage out. So what happens when we defecate? We have distension of the rectal wall, in other words, an increase in internal rectal pressure, and some reflexes are activated. At 18 millimeters mercury of pressure, the internal anal sphincter will relax due to the influence of the parasympathetic nerves firing off due to the reflex. And at this point, you develop an urge to defecate. However, you'll still be able to hold it in for a little while longer due to the effect of the external anal sphincter, which is a skeletal muscle supplied by the pudendal nerve, and through it you can increase the pressure at the sphincter to prevent all that stool coming out once that internal anal sphincter relaxes, so you still have some time to run to the toilet. However, it can only maintain continence up to 55 millimeters mercury of pressure. Once your rectal content builds up to this pressure, you then have reflexive relaxation of your external anal sphincter, and whether you like it or not, all that stool is going to come out your ass. So this is a reflex evacuation, as under control of the sacral parasympathetic nerves. Now what should happen actually is that once that pressure of 18 millimeters mercury builds and starts to rise, that what should happen is that you kind of have a bit of time to run to a toilet, and you sit on the toilet, and then you can artificially build up that pressure to 55 millimeters mercury to allow that reflexive relaxation and evacuation. And the way you build up the pressure there is by contracting of your abdominal muscles and by doing a Valsalva maneuver. So when you take a deep breath, the diaphragm pushes downwards and you go like that by closing your epiglottis, and that builds up the pressure, and then external anal sphincter relaxes and everything can come out. Not only that, but when the pressure builds up, your puborectalis muscle relaxes. By relaxing this muscle, your anorectal angle reduces from about 90 degrees to about 15 degrees. So it's almost like instead of still having to go around a bend, it now turns into a straight tunnel almost. Not only that, but the sphincter descends to the pelvic floor, so it's easier to get out. So some effect of these things is that the passage is opened out, and there's a pressure gradient of low pressure outside your bum and lots of pressure inside your pelvis, and the stool follows the pressure gradient and escapes into the toilet or into the hole you've dug if you are somewhere in the middle of nowhere. Okay, so here's an illustration just to explain in pictures what I said in the previous slides. Over here we've got the puborectalis muscle and the external anal sphincter. To keep it simple, I haven't drawn an internal anal sphincter, but you can assume it's somewhere inside here. What happens is that usually the puborectalis muscle is quite contracted, and it pulls the colon into an angle, almost a 90 degree angle, which blocks the passage out. And the external sphincter is contracted, which pinches the colon tight and closed and elevates it away from the pelvic floor. Now when you are defecating, the puborectalis muscle relaxes, which allows this angle to go to 15 degrees, so it's more of a straight passage out. The external anal sphincter relaxes, so there's a nice big wide open passage. There's descent to the pelvic floor, which shortens the length of this passage, and all the stool can nicely go out. Look. To the toilet. Let's mention the gastrocolic reflex. Gastric distension seems to initiate rectal contraction and gives you the urge to defecate. It's especially strong in children. So So typically children will eat and then poo straight afterwards. And this is probably due to the effect of gastrin on the rectum. Okay, I'm going to take the opportunity to discuss the role of fiber. Any food that is ingested but not digested can be referred to as fiber, and examples are cellulose, hemicellulose, lignin, some polysaccharide molecules, and some gums. And they seem to stimulate colon activity and bowel movement, and they also stimulate the growth of mucosa, and possibly they may reduce the incidence of gastrointestinal related illnesses like polyps and gastric cancers. This hasn't been properly proven though, so it's still only possibly rather than definitely. And people that don't eat enough fiber typically are constipated, they have reduced bowel movements, and they're more, and they seem to be more prone to disorders of the mucosa, such as ulcerations and inflammations. Fiber can be given as medication. Because of that stimulation of colon activity and bowel movement, they have a laxative effect, and patients that are in ICUs or have only parenteral feeding, you can give fiber either as an enema or for a stoma, and that fiber, even though you're not really digesting much through the colon because of your parenteral feeding, if you're given a little bit of fiber, it prevents colonic atrophy in such patients. Next, we're going to discuss constipation and diarrhea, starting with constipation. Okay, normal defecation varies from anything from 3 times daily to once every 3 days. It varies very much from person to person. And the problem is if your transit time is too long, all the water in your feces is absorbed, and feces should consist of about 75% water. And if that water is sucked out of the feces, you're going to have hard, dry stools, which are not smooth, which are not slimy, and they're difficult to push out, difficult to defecate out. And therefore you have constipation once you have this situation developing. And the symptoms include anorexia and mild discomfort, although constipation is never hardly ever life-threatening as such, and that can cause quite a significant amount of discomfort for the patient. And constipation may also be caused by inhibition of your reflexes, loss of the muscle tone, or spasm of the muscles of the colon and rectum. Okay, diarrhea is the opposite of constipation. You have decreased transit time, increased peristalsis, and often you'll have hypersecretion, and the net result will be frequent watery stools. And there are a number of causes of diarrhea. I'm not going to go into an exhaustive list here. It's going to be infections, inflammatory bowel disorders, drug reactions, etc., etc. And you can die from diarrhea, even especially children. One of the most common causes of death in childhood in Africa is diarrhea. And the reason for that is that you lose enormous amounts of water, and water then follows a sort of osmotic gradient, it moves from the human body into the lumen. And you lose potassium and sodium, and water will follow the sodium again into the gastric lumen, so you end up having reduced total body water at a time when you're losing water through the diarrhea, and ultimately you have hypovolemia and low blood pressure. Not only that, but you're losing all your electrolytes, you don't have electrolyte disturbances, and the combination of low blood pressure and low electrolyte levels with dysregulation of the cardiac rhythm and your